Yes, we cannibal. Welcome to this week's edition of Meat Meat.
Our history is rich with pain and mayhem, violence.
Stupid.
Welcome to this week's edition of Meat Meat. I'm Liz Lesner, one half of Yes We Cannibal, an anti-hierarchical arts collective space here in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. This is Meat Meat 17 with Amber Dennis, a dear friend who I met in Buffalo, New York. Amber got her BFA in art history at the University of San Francisco, and since then she's been organizing folks, curating shows, basically moving people and artworks to create amazing collections of ideas and communities. She'll be talking today about her project Women on the Edge. This grew out of a collective project called Feminista Social Club, where she curated exhibitions and physical spaces. Her desire to transcend those limitations of space led her to Women on the Edge, which she calls a digital zine celebrating emotion from the mundane to extreme. And she's been using her launch parties where she reveals these editions to fundraise for mutual aid groups supporting people of color. We'll be talking to her about the genesis of that later. And without further ado, hi Amber, thanks for joining us.
Hi, hello. Yeah, thank you so much for having me. Thank you, Liz. Thank you, Matt. Yes, We Cannibal in general. Very happy to be here and talk about my little zine. So I figured, I guess, I would just probably talk a little bit about like my inspiration behind it, kind of how I started doing it. And then I'd show some of the kind of like my favorite selections from the last 6 or 7 zines that I've done. One of which is something I made, so. I guess I'm gonna launch right into it. Also, just a heads up, this is like, the entire zine, everything about it is like very much about emotion, so like, all of it's very personal and like coming from a heightened emotional space, kind of, just like, nothing really neutral about any of this, so. Personally, someone who kind of operates from a very emotional space, pretty much at all times, like an emotion first kind of person, which I guess historically is kind of a place of shame often for Black folks and Black queer folks, as I am too, which is a lot of the reason why I started the zine. It's kind of in response to that, the way kind of our emotions are policed, both physically and kind of, in less tangible ways. And it was also kind of, in a very personal way, a response to a very kooky 2019 I had, where my emotions were at an all-time high. I was married, I broke up with my husband, I came out, I had a series of very complicated lesbian relationships back to back. And like, I was really experiencing my own emotions in a way that, honestly, like I felt like I hadn't since like puberty. You know what I mean? It was like a pretty like odd space to be in. And I got weirdly very attached to this this piece by this German artist named Gregor Schneider. He's like a very odd white German man. And so I'm not positive. I think there should be a video in the background, I think, that's happening. That's just kind of a, just kind of for context for what I'm going to talk about for a little bit, that shows pictures of the piece. I think it was pretty famous, and it was like at the 2001 Venice Biennale, where he represented Germany, his country. So like the pictures are kind of that, so you can kind of just place what I'm saying. And yeah, I'm gonna jump into that. But the piece is called, I'm not gonna mess up the German pronunciation. It's called essentially Dead House. And it's this recreation of essentially his childhood home that he'd kind of continuously been working on since the age of 16. And like the kind of bare bones description of it, it's like there's like the house exterior stays the same, but the inside is this kind of constant, in this constant state of alteration. So like walls in front of walls, rooms within rooms, stairs to nowhere, you know what I mean? Ceilings under ceilings. Soundproof chambers, like very spooky, very spooky. Obviously supposed to be kind of like physically and emotionally, psychologically disorienting. But also is like this very kind of intense and personal piece. Obviously it's in his childhood home. Actually a quote from him. It also feels a little kooky to, but I want to be honest, like that this piece by this white man did kind of somewhat inspire the way I started thinking about the zine. So, but you know, we live in a society. I won't, you know what I mean? I won't pretend like this wasn't kind of what got me to the place I am, kind of been working this stuff out. But this quote from him, which is very kooky, essentially was, "I dream about taking the whole house away with me and building it somewhere else. My father and mother would live in it. Older relatives would lie dead in the cellar. My brothers would live upstairs. Round about there would be men and women who don't quite know where else to go. I am somewhere in there too, constantly rebuilding everything." And like in 2019, when I started, the zine, I really found myself connecting to this very much for some reason. And just this idea of this kind of like 16-year-old German teen essentially building a monument to his own emotional state and what it looked like to essentially have something so personal and so tied to your own kind of mental processing of like home and trauma become essentially representative of a facet of the human experience and like literally, I guess, in the Biennale that the country is from. Like a lot of the reviews and stuff at the time kind of focused on these like general larger ideas of around domesticity, mortality, you know what I mean? Claustrophobia of existing, like, you know, all that good stuff. But obviously, you know, we don't all have the same connection to home and death. And it's a very much a Western view, but was treated as if it was a Western and white view, but treated as if this it was this kind of universal understanding of like the human experience and human understanding. And yeah, and it was literally something he made over 15 or 16 years, like, in his childhood home. So like, and even in his talking about it is saying how personal it is, but kind of the outside view of the art world is viewing it as if it's representing all of us essentially in the way we engage with spaces. But tying this kind of back to the zine, and like, yes, shout out to this white German man, it essentially kind of inspired me to think about like, what if I tried to create a digital space that like embraced, elevated, amplified, very niche heightened emotions, like, and kind of treated them specifically from Black and Brown people and artists with the intellectual significance and I think the respect that they deserve that is often just kind of often given to white, cis, straight male artists or the, you know, the more marginalized you are, the more, usually the less respect you get. So, and obviously not to kind of mimic the system that overvalues them and devalues us, but to kind of reconsider the things we create like how they're viewed and how they're positioned. And to kind of move away from wanting to be interpreted as neutral representations, like embrace that kind of specificity and that like heightened emotional state. Kind of work on not letting it be so clouded by who made it and who wrote about it. You know what I mean? Like that, maybe not treating that as the kind of the most important value of a piece of work, essentially. So all that to say, I kind of wanted to start this zine to counter that way of experiencing and viewing art. As Liz said, kind of to celebrate emotion from the mundane to the extreme and present work in a way that's like hyper subjective, essentially. And treat that subjectivity with the respect I think it deserves. I'm gonna share some of my kind of my fave vids from the last six zines or so. Each one has a prompt. They're all kind of like little nonsensical diary entries that I kind of wrote at the beginning of each of them, connected to the theme. It's also, that would be the prompt that I would give the artist or the collaborator, so they could do with it what they will and create something to share. So yeah, I guess I'll get into the first one. So the first zine that I ever did, the theme was business in general. I'll read the prompt. Let's see. What's more important to our emotional existence in this capitalist hellscape than business? Big or small, it'll come for us all, yet no one ever asks us how we feel about it. Until now, in this first installment of Women on the Edge, you'll see work that focuses on the feelings behind the transaction. And the piece I have from this one is by a very talented artist, Buffalo-based, actually now she's in Troy, but her name is Man Tran Nguyen. And this piece is called For Vanessa. It's from 2018.
Vanessa works at Classy Nails. It's a small nail salon in the suburbs, somewhere in Western New York. Her parents own the salon, and it's been in existence since November of 2000, or so she remembers. Well, that's when she recalls moving to this place, to the nail salon. The clientele at Classy Nails are not a diverse group of humans, mostly white, Protestant women named Pam, Sue, or Mary, somewhere between the ages of 30 to 60. Well, maybe even a little older than that, because there's an old folks home across the way and we tend to get a lot of business from there. The ladies tend to have similar jobs and lifestyles and all know each other somehow. But this is a small town, roughly 30,000 people. Maybe it'll be easier for you to envision it if I put it this way. The whole population is small enough to fill all of Fenway Park and still have about 7,000 seats to spare. Or actually, the town's population would fill all of Tropicana Field in St. Petersburg, Florida, and it's also a destination hotspot for the clients of Classy Nails. Vanessa's never been to Florida. She usually can't get the time off. We only close on Sundays, so from 10 a.m. to 8 p.m. she's here. Unless it's Saturday, then we close at 6. This is a working-class town. Not liberal and not too conservative. I mean, it's conservative, but not a threatening amount. But hey, we don't talk about politics here. It's a bad idea. Trust me, she's done it. It's been a challenge to stay entertained here at times. The winters are a particularly slow time of the year, and she's got creative ways to pass time. Her parents have also found ways to keep busy. At the waiting area, there are stacks of magazines from a few years ago. So if you wanted to know what Us Weekly thought about Charlize Theron in May of 2015, read on. There's also a small library of DVDs. About 70% of them are Vietnamese variety shows, and the rest are a few very well-known cinematic masterpieces like Pretty Woman, You've Got Mail, and The Ocean's box set. She's watched each of these movies about 100 times, maybe even more. She can recite the movie at the drop of a dime. These are movies her mom chose to buy to watch with English subtitles, to learn how to speak English. It wasn't a total accident that the first few English-learning movies were Julia Roberts films. Her mom, Sandy, likes to tell customers that Julia Roberts taught her English. Classy Nails never gave in and got cable. It wasn't until the summer of 2016 that they had Wi-Fi, so growing up there was a lot of repeating images on the television. Either Vietnamese variety shows or a few chick flicks and the occasional obligatory action film that we had to play for the husbands that were suckered into waiting for their wives to finish up their nail appointments. In these variety shows, the same kind of representations flickered. Pretty, doe-eyed Vietnamese girls were serenaded by those dudes that sang cheesy songs to them. I think this one's about spring or something like that. Or these hot babes would dance their troubles away and tell you about a sensational love so true. I think this one's about heaven or something like that. We always have these playing in the background. We say it's for the customers, but they have no idea what these people are saying. So, really, it's for us. Some customers seem to really like it, and some say mildly orientalizing things about it. Really different. We are really different, after all. The ones that don't like it are usually the ones that are really annoyed with us speaking in Vietnamese to each other, and also really dissatisfied with my mom gossiping into her headset to her other nail salon owning friends about their other nail salon owning friends. She says that she gossips in Vietnamese to protect the innocent, because you know who is borrowing money from so-and-so again. Also, it's not for you to understand, so chill out, lady. My mom says that white people have a strange desire to be liked and are so paranoid sometimes. I used to have this reoccurring dream that I was at work and I couldn't leave, and it was really surreal because I would have to wake up and go back to work. I could walk around this place blindfolded and know where everything is, which is maybe more telling of the place than it does me. It hasn't changed much in the last 18 years. We might have moved tables around here and there, but really it's kept its form. I guess in a weird way it's been able to freeze time. A lot of people have their favorite polishes, and since some brands like to be creative with names of the polishes, it's not hard to remember. An Affair in Red Square, Pompeii Purple, I Am What I Amethyst, and the ever so popular I'm Really Not a Waitress. I lost count of how many times clients say something to the degree of, "Well, whose job is it to give these polishes these silly names? I want that job." Me too, Sue. Me too. Vanessa is such a pretty name. Is that your real name? Why would you say that to me? Am I not Vanessa material? Maybe they've gathered the fact that I'm a foreign baby and that Vanessa wasn't always Vanessa. It's Van, actually. Well, Vung. But I got sick and tired of saying that it means clouds in Vietnamese. Well, actually, it's supposed to be paired with my second first name. Vietnamese people tend to have two first names. And my second first name is this noise that you really can't make, only because you're not used to saying it. It's no. And then they'd ask me to repeat it, and I'd say never mind. And since I don't feel like explaining Nelp Vung or Van, or I chose Vanessa. It's gotten Van within it, so I'm comfortable enough with it. I hate being called Vanessa outside of Classy Nail. So at 1 minute past 6 p.m. on Saturdays, I get to be Van, Vung, or Nelp Vung until Monday comes around.
Cool. Yeah, so I'll keep chugging along. And then, yeah, I know we're going to talk a little after, so I won't go into kind of specifics about anything quite yet. But so the next one, the next theme was growth. And the prompt is bigger and better, sure, but what about biggest and betterest? You know, I'm talking enveloping whole city blocks in your constant expansion. You're growing, baby, and there's no stopping you. But how does that make you feel? In this installment of Women on the Edge, you'll see work that focuses on the feelings behind a constant forward momentum. And this next piece is by Hope Mora, no longer a Buffalo-based artist, I think Texas-based now. I'm not exactly sure where. It's called Imagined Futures. It's from 2019.
said, this is not the way things are supposed to be. This is not the way things are supposed to be. This might be the way they are now, but they are not supposed to be this way. She said, this is not the way things are supposed to be. This might be the way they are now, but they are not supposed to be this way. And she said, they will not always be this way.
Keep chugging right along. So this next one, the theme was, why would you say that to me? And here's the prompt. In honor, this is in February of 2020, I think. In honor of Black History Month, Valentine's Day, and I don't know, leap year, we're asking the eternal questions like, hey, what's going on here? Or, are you okay? And the eponymous, why would you say that to me? Which is to say, we want to get to the emotional bottom of those interactions that feel so heightened that they become weird and almost baffling. In this installment of Women on the Edge, you'll see work that focuses on the feelings behind an unexpected interpersonal escalation. This one's very personal because I made this one. Like a baby's first video art, so. But it is called, Danger Music Soul Child part one. I can explain it after when Liz and I talk, but here it is.
Similar to now, but the key to breaking curses and generational trauma is trust. Trust in yourself, in your awareness, and your intuition.
Hey, I think I'm jumping back in. That was for the next one. Do y'all have the vid, or should we just, we can move on to the next one too. That's totally okay.
Maybe you could give us a little bit of context while we sort some technical issues about what prompted you to make your own work for that piece, and then hopefully we'll get that queued up and we'll let you know when we have it queued up.
Sounds good. So I first off, planned poorly that month, so I needed another piece. I can direct y'all to the actual zine, like the website and stuff. Each zine has like two or three pieces. The other ones are like, I think for this one were like a couple writing pieces. So obviously it's hard to share that in this format, in this medium. But so I did need to fill a space, but also it's something I had been thinking about making. And as I said, very much driven by my own emotions, I had had a bad breakup. And I was kind of inspired to make this kind of like goof about the kooky emotions I was dealing with at the time. And yeah, Danger Music is, I think like 1960s, like Fluxus kind of stuff. But is essentially these, Dick Higgins was this composer who had these kind of like list of, not lists, what would we call them? Compositions that he would make on these little cards, but they were all kind of like things that a person could not physically do or something, but it was music, you know what I mean? Like a person couldn't physically, like one of them was, I'm trying to think of one that's off the top of my head. Or it was things that weren't music. So there were some things you could physically do. Like one was just the word scream over and over again six times. And that was like a musical composition. Yes. Okay, sorry, I'm just getting some notes. Totally. But yeah, I can also talk, I think we're gonna move on to the next prompt. And so I can actually introduce that video that y'all saw a little bit of. That's a part of a larger piece. And then we might look at mine at the end, we'll see. okay, skipping past that one. This theme for these next few pieces, the theme was trust. And I'm gonna read the prompt to y'all. Your family, your friends, your own reflection, is anyone worthy of it? No, are you yourself? Who can I run to? A person, a group of people, a series of concepts embodied all lead to one place. Who, or dare I say, what can you? In this installment of Women on the Edge, you'll see work that focuses on the feelings behind past betrayals and future confidences. And this one's a bit longer. It's four pieces by a dear friend of mine, an artist. Everyone's been my friend also, but her name is Blaine Morris. Each piece is a different element, so water, earth, fire, air. So I'll let them cue that up.
Can look eerily similar to now, but the key to breaking curses and generational trauma is trust. Trust in yourself, in your awareness, and your intuition. Maybe the biggest part of trust is faith in your higher self, your inner teacher and our true keepers of hope, a calling of service to be committed to be a seeker on the path, a seeker after truth.
Thank you.
when Zuko is sick after he frees Appa, I notice a really interesting connection to Chinese medicine and the concept of shanghuo. Chinese medicine is based off of yin and yang and like balance within your body, and there's this concept of shanghuo in Chinese medicine, which translates directly to English as on fire, but it doesn't mean your body's literally on fire. It's more of like a sense of overheatedness because your body's imbalanced and the yin and yangs like aren't balanced with each other, and your body's kind of fighting itself. And Zuko in that episode was definitely shanghuo, because even Iroh said like, this is an unnatural fever, like your body's fighting itself, you need to find balance. I can't explain this perfectly in English simply because the concept shanghuo does not exist in the English language, and there's no way to really describe it in English. And there's a concept that language shapes the way you perceive the world, and that's absolutely true. I understand Mandarin, so I understand this feeling of shanghuo. I know what it means. But when I talk to my friends who only know English, they don't understand what shanghuo is. Like, they don't know what that feeling feels like. And if you know Mandarin, do you know what I'm talking about with this scene in Zuko and shanghuo? So I was rewatching the Earth.
After all, paths are made by walking. Your higher self stands firmly on a secure foundation of trust, hope, and faith.
You've always thrown everything you could at me! Well, I can take it! And now I can give it back!
Put your trust in hope and you can embody the faith you have in yourself. Ultimately, trust is our own inner conflict, the battlefield of our collective hero's journey. After all, paths are made by walking. Your higher self stands firmly on a secure foundation of trust, hope, and faith. Put your trust in hope and you can embody the faith you have in yourself. Ultimately, trust is our own inner conflict, the battlefield of our collective hero's journey.
Hey. Okay, yeah, so now I've got, besides my vid, we've got one more. And this is actually the zine I just posted today. I just put it up today. The theme is return. And yeah, I'm sure we can link to something or something or other somewhere to point in the right direction. So you can see the full zine and the other ones too. But here's the prompt. Much like the Sankofa tattoo I got on my inner left bicep in a particular moment of auntie lucidity, the idea of looking behind to see what you may have dropped feels permanent. Vacillating between hyper-sentimental but strategically generalized reflection and a very deep, specific longing for the Magic Johnsons, TGI Fridays, and Moldera Heights, seems you'll always wonder whether or not your dreams really were your ticket out. In this installment of Women on the Edge, you'll see work that focuses on the feelings behind being unequivocally lost at sea. This last piece is by Zenzele Johnson. It's called A Visual Daydream, and she literally just made it.
Look at my heart.
Yeah, so I mean, that's all, yeah, that's all I got, unless the other one's popping up. But
we're going to find that for you. But in the meantime, I thought we could just maybe talk a little bit about, you know, kind of your impetus for starting this work, some of the mutual aid stuff you've been doing, because when I met you, you were doing Feminista Social Club, which was a collective that you produced curated exhibitions, but you also had like a community organizing aspect to it. And I think you, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think you guys also wrote things together, and there was like a publication aspect to it. So I'd love to hear about, you know, when you kind of started putting these shows together and tying that to your kind of community building work.
Let's see. Yeah, I mean, I think my idea of like curating has always included kind of a community-based element. I mean, listen, obviously, I'm a caricature of myself and a broken record. Like, I do think in particular, like in Black communities and in Black queer communities, there is kind of a holistic view and idea of art and art making and art producing, and something that is very collaborative to get to a certain place. So I kind of, that is maybe kind of how I thought of the mutual aid work kind of fitting into that, like kind of collective, you know, all that buzzy shit, like collective care, et cetera, fits in just to kind of the way that I like to make and share things. And then I guess how, yeah. So this just seems like somewhat of a natural progression, since it did start as kind of me doing these shows, but also connected to like the community work and stuff of Feminista Social Club. We would do like fundraisers and events for like, you know, different, you know, they were not women's causes. Sounds very, very odd, second wave feminist, but just kind of like, you know, organizing around treating other people with dignity and respect, I guess, is like the foundation of it. But we'll call that feminism. And so kind of when I stopped doing the physical space, the Feminista Social Club and the physical shows, I wanted to figure out a way to kind of continue that in a digital space. And then obviously the pandemic made it so that I could only really do digital organizing and digital curating. And that's how it shifted into what it is now, if that answers the question.
So that brings up something really interesting, I think, which is, what is your idea of curating? And I know that you did an art history undergraduate degree, so I'd imagine that you had an idea of curating that was shaped or modified by that degree, and that there's been an evolution over the course of your work as a curator, as an exhibitor, as an organizer to this point. So I'd love to hear about that evolution from the academic setting to what you're doing now.
I mean, I'm sure like as a baby, like being in school, I was like, I'm gonna work at, you know, maybe like a curator at MoMA, like I'm gonna get a PhD, like da da da, you know what I mean? All these kind of like hallmarks for like a career in working in the arts at like whatever, a highly respected level. That shifted by necessity. Truly did not want to get into more debt going to grad school and going to grad school. And also, truly, I mean, no disrespect to anyone, no shade or anything like that, but just see like how I was treated in different art spaces made me realize that no amount of achievement is going to change the way that I am viewed in an art space. You know, or is going to change the way like people see my value in an art space, which made me move away from wanting to do really anything that was kind of traditionally institutional. I didn't want to be kind of consistently disappointed. You know what I mean? And so it felt, what felt kind of good and right to me was to try to create something that like allowed for me and like showed me and the people that I surround myself with like the respect I think we deserve kind of in our creative pursuits and the things, you know, the things we're working on. And the only way I could really see to do that, there obviously are all sorts of great kind of like spaces that do value like people outside of just kind of like white cis straight men. By no means am I saying that, that there aren't any. But I wanted to just kind of with my crew and the people I knew create that, something like that for ourselves. And that's kind of how it came to fruition. And how I kind of left my art history degree behind. I appreciate it, I love it. I still love art history and et cetera in museums, but yeah, definitely the idea of working within them shifted pretty drastically for me over the last, whatever, 15 or so years since I've been out of college, 10 years maybe.
Can I ask a segue question here, Amber? I am dying to know what you think about the whole Philip Guston deferral by these major institutions. Have you followed that story?
I don't know if I followed that one super. Oh, the show, yes. This is the Philip Guston show where there are a lot of images that have the Klan in them, right? Am I, is that the right one? Okay. Yes, I do. I've followed that a tiny bit.
Said that they were not going to show this work because it was not the right time for it, and they wanted to reassess putting these images out there.
Yeah, listen, I am never kind of going to be the person who's like another white man's retrospective. You know what I mean? For sure, like that's not really something I'm. Despite how much I talked about Gregor Schneider at the beginning, that's not something I'm super drawn to in like an artistic experience, just kind of inherently. But yeah, I guess I just don't necessarily, even outside of the time and the place, didn't necessarily feel like a show that was like really important to show right at any time. That's very rude. I don't mean that in a way that like the work's not valuable or important, but like, right, a white man depicting kind of like white kind of like specters or like representations of white violence, for who and for what reason? What, like, you know what I mean? Like, and like what purpose is it serving, really, is kind of my ultimate feeling that I would maybe feel no matter what, even if it was outside of like, you know what I mean? The great white reckoning of understanding police brutality.
It's interesting to hear your take, because I think that his, you know, grappling with the sort of evil within himself, which is something that he sort of talked about, it's interesting, you know, is there a place for that? Is there a place for that in this current moment for a kind of, even though we've seen this many times over, is there in this current context of the George Floyd uprising, of all of these things, is there a place for reckoning with the evil of oppression by the oppressor?
I definitely think that there is a place, obviously, like a system that you created and benefit from the most, you should be doing the most work to dismantle it. But sometimes I think like I guess, yes, I respect, obviously wanting to kind of reckon with what that means for you as a white person, and essentially what your lineage is. But is it actually really in particular doing anything to dismantle like what is happening really on a happening like viscerally and in our faces on a daily basis? Like what is a retrospective doing in that regard, you know? I think maybe it's just like we are past a time when you maybe could get a pat on the back for just acknowledging that something is wrong, which essentially is what I feel like that work does. Like, right, something's off. We all knew that. People have always been saying that. People are somewhat more willing to listen now. But it doesn't really necessarily do that much, at least for me personally, for a white person to be like, wow, things are bad. You know what I mean? The Klan is bad. Like, and I'm also white, you know, like, if that makes sense.
What work do you feel is doing that work? And what would you like to see in the stead of that?
I mean, I guess in general, what I would like to see instead is, really and truly kind of like giving space to Black and Brown artists, like who are actually dealing with whatever particular oppression it is that we're addressing in a significant way, and not kind of just like in these flashpoint moments, you know what I mean? Where it's like, oh, we have to respond to this, like, so people don't think our institution is A, B, or C. When for the most part, yes, that is, your institution is that. Like, so ultimately kind of putting a Black or Brown face in front of it, like, you know what I mean, for a couple of years in your programming, isn't really dealing with the heart of the matter. So truly, I don't even necessarily, I always want to see more like Black and Brown people, and there are obviously even more marginalized identities within being Black and Brown as generalization. Like, obviously there's so much within that, but to kind of go into and to address in different levels of kind of like, you know, power dynamics and oppression within even marginalized communities. But I don't know. I think I would like to see maybe more things that actually grapple with particular institutions' histories and the people that are supporting them and funding them, et cetera. And that is probably not gonna happen because, you know what I mean? You probably won't keep getting money if you admit all your board or trustees are like arms dealers, you know what I mean? So, yeah, I don't know if that makes sense.
That's a great segue into your work with mutual aid. I'd love to hear about how you started doing that and, you know, what your inspiration was from that and where you're going with that work now with Women on the Edge.
So I feel like in this conversation, I'm kind of being like, that's bad, that's bad, that's bad. I do also want to recognize that like, there are systems at play within me that I also perpetuate, you know what I mean? And play into and have to unlearn. And think of a different way of operating in terms of like engaging with and caring for other people. So all that to say, I've drawn to mutual aid just because I feel like there's often, how do I put it? Often I feel like people have to perform a need to get support. You know what I mean? Like, and that feels weird and exploitative. and it's often looking for support outside of the community that you're in, which, listen, money is money for sure. I've never fault anyone for taking it. That's not the issue. But something feels different to me about, yeah, like, you know, actual solidarity and actually taking care of the people around you. And acknowledging that also you could be in a position of needing support. It is not someone to like, you know, It's not charity. It's not someone to pity. It's not, it's, you know, it's a position almost giving from a place of like, I don't see myself separate from these other people asking for support. And I feel like in a way, sometimes not all kind of nonprofits or like charity-based organizations are like this, but a lot is kind of a top-down weird kind of like philanthropy view, as opposed to like, we're all in the muck. We all need to support each other, if that makes sense.
Can you tell us a little bit about how Women on the Edge does, like how you decide who to work with for which issue? And I know that you've also done things like raffles to support individuals in the community, how you kind of settled on that and who you're working with in that way.
So I will be honest, this like is truly like kind of loose as a goose. Like I have not been doing it so long that I've actually figured out the right way to approach stuff exactly. But yeah, it started out truly like I was working with my buds. I was like, there, you know, other buds that were like artists and stuff who wanted to do shit but didn't have the space, or like maybe weren't actively kind of working with the arts in a way where they would be offered the space. And then kind of it went from there. Like I would reach out to people kind of directly that I like thought were making interesting work and stuff, or I would just even like on kind of like Instagram or whatever, put out like a call for work and like make it pretty clear that like we were trying not to have a kind of narrow view of what art is or whatever, you know what I mean? That it could be kind of a wide range of stuff. As long as it's somewhat connected to the theme and the prompt, like, you know, just so it didn't kind of make people feel like, oh, well, I'm not an artist because I'm not doing A, B, or C, you know what I mean? And also made sure that once I was able to, I was offering stipends so that I wasn't asking people to do stuff for free, which often I think limits the people's capacity if you're asking them to do things for free. And the mutual aid stuff, there's truly like to all of these like really great mutual aid accounts, and like a lot of them are like often Black and brown women who are like in situations themselves, and they're like seeing a need and wanting to support people around them, and just have created these like amazing accounts where they're just constantly sharing. So I would just kind of, I mean, I would just pull from those really. And then, yeah, the raffles, I was very lucky that people would donate kind of time, tarot readings, clothes, etc., that I could just raffle off for like $3 a ticket. And then the amount of money we would get, I would split it. I would try to usually do 100 per person, like responding to mutual aid, like calls for support.
Do you have plans to kind of grow that aspect of Women on the Edge? Or I know, because when we started talking, you were asking us to sort of reach out to organizations here, which sadly that didn't quite work out for this meet. But do you have like a direction you want to take that? Is that becoming more prominent to you? I know COVID really sort of made a lot of things about what you're doing with Women on the Edge coalesce. So did that kind of change your idea about this aspect of the Women on the Edge practice?
Yeah, I mean, I think no matter what, there would be the kind of community-based part, like the community model, I guess, of it all is pretty important to me. And I think it just happened to be like, this was the best way to continue that, like in this time and place. And yeah, I would like to. I definitely will admit, like have fallen off of kind of doing it as regularly, and I'm trying to kind of get back into, you know, asking people for money, particularly asking my people for money so I can send it to other Black and brown people. But yeah, I think the plan is to ease back into doing it. But no matter what, I mean, I like feel comfortable saying this, when I can, for the most part, every month I budget I try to budget $300 of my paycheck to put towards this mutual aid pot. So, which is kind of a way to keep me like, this should be something like, if I can, right? Like, I should be supporting my relatives, you know what I mean? Like, so I guess even if it's not necessarily happening within Women on the Edge, it is something that I personally am trying to continue doing. And ideally, if I can, I would like to kind of try to reincorporate it back into the zine, in the work of the zine.
What does the kind of zine history, you know, how does that connect to your video project and what you're doing now? And I know that you also are quite a writer. And do you ever see reintegrating that into the current zine format that you're using?
I am very lazy, so I don't necessarily know that I'll be doing any more long form writing. like kind of writing the props for Women on the Edge has scratched that itch for me for sure. Yeah, and I mean, I think zine is something I kind of just picked as a grouping of things that's like kind of loose and like it doesn't necessarily have to fit a particular prescribed format that has a theme. I was like, a zine. And a zine felt also just like, as I've said before, at least like in my experiences of zines, an art form that does allow for heightened emotional spaces and heightened emotion to be shared easily and widely. And that's kind of the thought behind calling it a zine, if that makes sense.
But also, you know, that history of doing it yourself and telling it yourself and putting out something that there isn't already a platform for. I mean, I really see you continuing in that tradition, you know?
Thank you. That's very kind. I am trying to do that. I do also recognize that being a digital zine is like, not everybody always has access to digital spaces in that way. So a zine, like a physical zine, is actually probably more egalitarian than a website, you know what I mean? So not quite as DIY as maybe it could be, but hopefully trying to keep that lineage.
What's next for Women on the Edge? What are the next issues looking like? And is there gonna be like a Women on the Edge compilation, a Women on the Edge digital book?
Oh, I never thought about doing something like that. Maybe. yeah, truly, you know, fly by the seat of my pants. I think I'm using the right term. So I ideally will do another one by the end of the year. I think for a while I was trying to do them bi-monthly and I could not keep that up. so I'm ideally going to try to do them like seasonally, like, you know, a winter one, a spring one, a summer one, a fall one. And I do not know what the next theme will be. I haven't quite worked that out yet, but yeah, we'll see.
How do you pick the themes?
I honestly just kind of wrote a list of general words. Like really, that's how I started it. And I would pull from them, or I would just kind of start writing something. And I'd be like, this is a thing I'm thinking about. And I would start writing the prompt. And then I'd be like, what is that theme, essentially, you know? So they're real loose. The themes are not like, I'm not precious about them.
And do you think that you'll ever do another physical exhibition? Or are you sort of moving away from that meat space? Are you moving away from that meat space?
I don't think I'm not like anti doing it. I would maybe just I mean, like at my advanced age, you know, I probably wouldn't just kind of agree to stuff just to do it in the way that I probably have in the past, you know? So yeah, if it was something that like worked out and was cute for everyone, I would for sure be able to be interested in doing more kind of like physical stuff, but trying to know my worth and be like, and make sure it's something that actually feels good to do, because I don't necessarily feel like I need a physical space, if that makes sense.
Okay, one final question, and then we're gonna ask you to reintroduce your video. Our apologies for this technical glitch. We're gonna cut it into the final documentation, so it will be available to watch on our YouTube channel. And also, please consider helping Yes We Cannibal produce more of these meet meets where we get to hear about interesting work that people all over the world are doing. Everyone from musicians to artists to authors to curators has a platform here, and from places that are around the corner in Baton Rouge to across the ocean in London. So if you are a fan of this work, please check out our Patreon, which we can post in the chat. And yeah, so Amber, what role does pleasure play in the work that you're doing?
Wow. I feel like it plays a big role. I definitely would consider myself like kind of a hedonist in that I only really like to do things that feel good. So I definitely feel like even if the kind of ideas or emotions that are being expressed are like intense or heavy, there is like foundationally like a pleasure in creating the zine and in collaborating with people. And in like actively actively sharing kind of like some of these more like personal and private like emotional spaces, if that makes sense.
Thank you so much, Amber. Please consider supporting Women on the Edge, and please consider supporting Yes We Cannibal. We're gonna post the Patreon links in the chat. Do you have any final words for us, Amber? If not, we're gonna ask you to reintroduce your video so that we can cut it in for our documentation.
I just wanna say thank you so much for having me. Hopefully I didn't say anything too kooky. But yeah, thank you so much for having me. This has been lovely. And I don't know how many people watched, but thank you for watching. And like my first Twitch, my first real salon. So, you know, thank you for bearing with me.
Thank you so much for joining us from New York. Tell us about your video one more time, please.
Yes. Okay. So this theme was, why would you say that to me? and the video was my first piece of video art, maybe my last. It's called Danger Music Soul Child Part One. And it is, it was my attempt at essentially making Danger Music compositions, which are not music, but like, I don't know how much of this from before will still be in here, but Danger Music was like a Fluxus art movement. And there was a person named Dick Higgins, and he would make these compositions. And often they were things either that people could not physically do that he would call music. I mean, I can't think of the specific one, but like, do you know what I mean? It was like, scoop your eyeballs out with a spoon. You know what I'm saying? It was like that kind of stuff. or one that was like, I think probably the most famous one, which is just like the word scream 6 times, you know what I mean? So like that's one someone could perform, but it's like a performance art movement from the 60s. And so I made one, a video of several about a breakup I had just had. And it is scored to a karaoke version of music like he was a he is, I don't know if he, Music Soul Child, who's an R&B artist from like early 2000s, who made this song called Love. And that is that's the music, the backing music, a karaoke version of it. But yeah.
Thank you.